just sit and pray. Just make sure that we're all praying and holding hands together. Yeah, we're excited. It's an exciting team, exciting new season, exciting new groups, new teams, new employees. So we're coming in fresh and, of course, just getting new. I'm sure all you guys are following us on Mavs.com, so you guys know who the team is. But we are excited, especially coming off the Western Conference Finals. While we did that in advance, we did beat Phoenix. So that was actually something really cool for us. Especially, it was almost like, you know what, we won. We can hang our hat here and say, okay, with the people that thought that we were going to win, we showed, proved them wrong. So that was good.
Absolutely. Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Dave Mullins. I'm the Senior Vice President of Client Development for an agency called Evolution. We're an integrated sports and lifestyle agency. We primarily work with brands on their sponsorships. So how do they think about sponsorship from a strategy? We negotiate the deals, we activate the deals, and we measure the efficacy of those deals. So delighted to be here with Iris Diaz, and I'm excited to get into a number of topics. But before we do, Iris, I was thinking we might want to just gauge the audience to see if we got some friendly territory here or not. So how many are NBA fans? Of you are Mavs fans. All right, good. Those two work for you. They don't count. I know we're in the heart of Spurs country, so I got to ask, how many Spurs fans in here?
Wow. I thought I converted you last night.
Yeah. Well, they're brave for saying they're Spurs fans. The glory days are over. So, what is everyone else? The Knicks fans? We got a New York crowd here? Well, Iris, I think in a room full of people that all have cool jobs, I feel like you probably have the coolest job out of anyone in this room. You know, CMO of the Mavericks, which of course it's an NBA team, but it's also a really good NBA team. You've got a great team, like you said, you went to the conference finals last year. I guess it'd be interesting just to hear your trajectory, your career trajectory. How did you get to where you are today?
Well, CMO was not the goal for me, for sure. I've been in marketing for 16 years. I actually got into marketing not knowing what marketing was. That is a true story. I was actually going to school for graphic design, and someone gave me a marketing assistant position job, and I was like, sure, I can do that. So I used to work at Albertsons grocery stores. I don't think they're even existing in Austin or in Dallas or anywhere else right now. But I used to be the marketing assistant there for the grocery store. So for me, it's like all I knew was what that was from the retail standpoint. Didn't realize that it was going to be my future in marketing and everything that I did. So I actually was there, and then I advanced over to the Dallas Morning News. I was overseeing the LDS Spanish newspaper. I was the marketing creative director there, and then advanced over to, I'm sure you guys know, iHeartMedia. I was there for about 5 years, and I was overseeing all of DFW, marketing creative director again for all the boards, all the beautiful little shiny digital boards that you guys see. So when I started, there was 36 boards. When I left, it was 142. So it was pretty intense working on projects like that. Then I moved over to agency. During that time, I was also looking at, I was going to be in sports. I already knew I was going to be in sports. I just needed to know, how do I get there? I was researching so many people that were from like CONCACAF, MLS, NHL, NFL, whatever it is. I was researching to see what they did to also get into sports, and they had agency background. So for me, I was like, well, I have to get into an agency. I went back to school, graduated from SMU, went into an agency, and I said, okay, this is it. So this was only going to be the agency. I was working for the Richards Group, and I was on the multicultural side. I was overseeing all the TV production for Metro PCS. So any campaigns that you saw in 2019, I was involved in that. And it was all nationwide too, so it wasn't just local, which was a different animal and different attacks, especially when
So obviously a lot of brands in the room, they all have seasonality to their business, right? You have an actual season where you play games. I think it'd be really interesting just to tell the audience how your planning cycle works. You know, how far are you looking ahead? You know, there's obviously a lot of variables. A player gets injured or traded or free agency. You know, how do you plan for that?
You don't plan for those changes. You just have to learn to be agile. You have to learn that that's one of the things actually we talk about when we're interviewing people coming into not only sports but just in the marketing department too. It's the understanding is that if something happens at 11 o'clock at night or something in the game, some player gets removed and they're the face of the next campaign that we're launching, we have to redo all that overnight. Are you willing and do you understand what that means? Because if you're coming from an 8-to-5 job, Mojito, you're not going to survive here. And that is the reality of what happens. So we just have to be ready, not ready for those moments, because media finds out before we find out. And that's how Secret Top Notch, they actually keep all that information. So for us, it's really making sure that we have the right people, like the two people that I have here, that understand that and know that if I'm not even 11, they're already reaching out to me saying, hey, we got to do this, and this is it, we're already on it. So for me, it's working with people like that make my job easier. So that way, we all understand that we all have to hold hands and pray at 11 o'clock at night when people are changing players, or that the score change, or that we have 3 straight losses, which we won't. But when we have 5 straight wins, we have to change our marketing and messaging of what it is. Hey, we're sold out on tickets, we can't sell anymore, we got to pull everything for tomorrow. I will say one of the incidents that we had this past season was when KP got traded at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and then we had a game at 7, and guess whose face was all over our graphics? KP. So I get a call from Derek sitting right there. He's like, hey, this is what's going on. What do you want to do? Pull everything, because it takes one person to tweet, it takes one person to post something on social, and it takes that same owner to come and say, hey, what's going on? So we have to make sure that we are on top of it, not only for ourselves, but it's for the fan at the end of it, so that way they have a good experience. But you just have to be ready for that, and that is the way the business is. And we do have seasons, and we do, many people ask, like, what do you do during the summer? Like, we have to plan for 41 parties. That's what we have to do. So while we have a smaller break, if you want to call it, that we're strategizing, we're planning out, we're recapping, we're trying to make sure that, did we do something right? What do we do? What do we need to change? How do we adapt? Now we have to change a whole roster because we have 7 new fellas in here. So it's all of it, and then trying to make sure that we're adapting to the new audience that we keep gaining every single year.
Well, let's talk about the work a little bit. You've been now 3 years as CMO, right? 4 years with the organization. Over that time, I guess the first question is, what are you most proud of that you've done? And then conversely, sports is really notorious for this, for putting something out and something just totally crashes and burns. So what are you most proud of, and then what just kind of didn't work where you learned a lot from it?
What I'm most proud of is the fact that when I started, I was the second marketing person there, and now I have a full team. That, I think, is the best thing, because if you don't have the resources to make sure that your business is advancing, get it. Now, it's just a detriment to your own business, and also to yourself, and also to the employees. But for me, I think that was one of the biggest wins, and the fact that I'm very
one of the biggest reasons why brands want to associate with you guys is to draft up the equity that you have with your fan base, right? They want to associate, get that halo effect, get the coolness factor from it. I'm curious, though, to flip that, have you ever worked with maybe a partner brand where you almost reversed it, where the Mavs drafted off of the coolness or the halo of a brand, and therefore it elevated both entities?
I would say one of our favorite ones, and I know it's alcohol, but AB does a really great job with a lot of their executions that they do, and they don't stray away from what they brand and what they represent. For us, that's really cool because guess what? People are coming to drink that with them and have a good time. So, but the way that they do stuff, one thing that I really, really love, and we're just talking about this, is they design new Coke designs every, new beer designs every single year, and we're a part of that. So the fact that they're able to do that, that we can leverage off that fan base, is always really cool and awesome. So I think that one, the new one that just came on that we are also working on with is Frito-Lay. Frito-Lay is now allowing our brand and our design to be on their, you know, Ruffles bags. But for us, it's like, could it be something as natural as that? Yes, but it's also, it's a different fan. It's the kids, it's the families that we also, not only maybe we're missing because they're not coming to a basketball game, maybe they're going to a soccer game or something else, but it's another audience that we don't get to touch every single day that we can through their brand. So I think AB and Frito-Lay have been doing it really well because they know their audience and they don't stray away from it. But I think the AB one is one that's really cool just because we're always able to tap your shoulder and say, hey, can we work something out for 41 parties? Or can we do something away in Phoenix? Can we do some watch parties in Fort Worth? You know, or can we do, and they're always ready and able to bring that fandom that we get to bring and that we get to bear to theirs. So theirs is actually really cool. If you guys don't work with them, I would recommend, just because it's their mentality of how they talk to their audience. It's very real.
So you guys have an exciting team. You guys, as you mentioned, were in the conference finals last year. You know, high expectations this year. You very clearly, though, have a superstar on your team in Luka Doncic. Global superstar, for those of you that don't know him. He's only 23, too. I had to look that up because he feels like he's been there forever. But I guess from a marketer standpoint, you're responsible for marketing the whole team. So how do you make sure you're not over-rotating on one global superstar and making sure you sort of spread the love to the rest of the team?
I think what happens too is the fans do that naturally. So that word of mouth goes a long way. When everyone's sharing, posting, talking about Luka, then we almost don't have to do it as much because the fans are doing it. But we do. We have to make sure that everyone gets that spotlight. It's not just Luka. Yes, it is Luka, and we all know how important he is to the team, but all the other players are equally important because they are helping and they are a team. One thing that we noticed, and something that you guys might not know, when you if you ever check out the press
here talking about digital. Iris, don't tell us what's new, tell us what's next.
You gotta find out. You really have to find out, because one thing that we started doing, yes, we started doing NFTs, and we're doing them again this year, where everyone that scans their ticket and goes to a game, you get a free NFT. Once you collect them all, obviously that's money in your wallet that you can trade. What's next? I mean, we're tapping into a lot of AI stuff. So that's actually what we're tapping. Really kind of testing out, because once you give it to a fan and then they go crazy and it's our name behind it, you gotta reel that in. But we are testing out a lot of AI right now to see how we bring that back. I think now that people are coming back into normal hours and normality and coming to an arena that, you know, for just like 3 years ago, we're coming back to some of the traditional stuff too that people are missing.
Great. Well, to close out, let's do a little lightning round. So I'll ask you a question if you can give me a quick answer. You ready? All right, what's the biggest misconception of working for a sports team?
That you need to know sports.
You mentioned Target yesterday. It sounds like a big Target fan, but I was going to ask you, brand you most admire, aside from Target, is?
Celsius.
Book you'd recommend for the audience to read?
Leaders Eat Last. Simon Sinek.
Got it. Will Luka win MVP this year?
Always.
Can you give me a Luka autograph?
No comment.
And finally, you got the Grizzlies tomorrow night in Dallas. What's the final score going to be?
You know what? It might be 110-113. Luka beating that buzz beater, bringing back that buzz beater 3-point shot.
Nice. You heard it here first. 113,